morning. First of all, thank you for the invitation, and that's the first time I've ever been in a conference trailer. Really nice. Thank you. I'm gonna give just a very short, maybe 20 to 30 minute introduction and show some pictures. I don't really have a script, so I'm just gonna go along the pictures and talk about something that I've titled Deep Shit Paradigms, Paranoia, and Politics of Machine Intelligence. To give you an insight into how big the role of artificial intelligence, something that we still perceive to be something not yet in existence, already is in our technological reality. Of course, you could say that the idea of reconstructing or re-engineering the way that both the human body and the human mind works is something that's at the very core of human epistemic endeavor ever since we started to think and we started to develop techniques of science and things like this. But in our particular case, I think we can trace it back to the year 1949 and the letter addressed to Norbert Wiener, the inventor of cybernetics, by his Chinese colleague Yuanren Chao. He's a very interesting fellow who was a linguist who in the very early 1920s worked as an interpreter for Albert Einstein and Bertrand Russell when they first visited China. Norbert Wiener himself spent a couple of years at Tsinghua University in Beijing in the early 1930s. So it stands to argue that his studies in the Chinese language and natural philosophy of Taoism and the yin-yang and the idea of circularity and feedback have had an influence on the way that he conceived of cybernetics and feedback circuitry. Here you can see that they talk about the game of Go as something that could be very interesting for a computer to be tackling. Go, as you know, is unlike chess, a much more complex game. Chess is something that's very easily broken by brute force. It took computing machinery a long time to do so, but I think it was in 1996 or 7 that Deep Blue, the big IBM computer, finally bet Kasparov. Go is very, very popular among computer scientists and mathematicians as a sort of model for computationally overly complex or non-solvable problems. And that leads people to think that it has something to do with the uniqueness of human intelligence or the human mind, that this is something still not doable by machines. Until 2016, last year, a software called AlphaGo by the company Alphabet, also known as Google, won 5 out of 6, I think, matches against Lee Sedol, whom you've seen here, quite pissed off, the great grandmaster of Go. Which actually resulted in a cultural shock in Korea. There were really funny newspaper articles about like masses of people getting shit-faced at night, and like really depressed drinking. And the next morning, the Korean government poured, I think, $1 billion into artificial intelligence research. So, because this was sort of the last frontier of artificial intelligence, something that people thought was only doable by human intuition, had finally been tackled by something artificial. And in a way that was not sort of retraceable by onlookers. So people were really discussing and saying, we really don't know why this software did this or that move. We have no idea. This is something entirely new. The software toolkit that AlphaGo is based on is something that you've also encountered before slightly earlier. 1 or 2 years ago, Google Deep Dream came into being. I think most of you have seen these kinds of images. They work by, they work along something called deep learning. But what they do basically is you train something, you train a system to do one particular task in a really, really highly professional way. In this case, it means I will give you 7 million images of dogs and towers, for example, and birds, and then every input that I give you, I will ask you to look for this particular pattern in there. So this is what you could, that's why it's called deep dreaming, or that's why they thought this is like a machine hallucinating, which I think kind of hits the spot, because this is what hallucinations do. You try to pick patterns out of something where they're actually not. It's in the human cognitive system, you call it pareidolia, where you see faces somewhere where there are no faces actually. So the funny thing is, while we had sort of, you know, funny images and games on the one hand, what happened in the background is that all the big companies like Google, Facebook, IBM, Intel, and so on, started completely reformulating the way that they were designing their infrastructure, and that is a global planetary infrastructure, building it on the foundation of artificial intelligence research. This is a logo you should remember. It's the logo for TensorFlow, which is the Google AI toolkit that all the deep learning stuff is built on. They released it as open source at the same time the AlphaGo singularity happened, which seems like a nice thing to do if you look at it from the outside, to give it to the public, to say every research institution can use it, every private citizen can use it if they want to. But it also means that they significantly increased their data influx. So if you look at the terms of use of this open source release of TensorFlow, you can see that by using it, you also allow, you basically start working for Google. It's not only a software change that's taken place, but also a hardware change. This is the so-called TPU, a tensor processing unit designed by Google. So it's, we have started to shift away from general purpose CPUs that a machine like this one has in them to, you know, that Bitcoin mining, for example, is already done on big supercomputers that don't really work with CPUs anymore, because general computation is not interesting for them. They just need to do one very specific thing really well. So they use graphics cards, for example. Now we have a lot of companies that start designing their own hardware. Facebook is doing so. This is the one designed by Google called the TPU. Intel has acquired a company called Nervana, which I really like, and started building their own hardware. And what happened just a short time ago is that all the big companies, all the people that you really like and that really like your data, have teamed up to create something called the Partnership on AI, which is an international cartel that's in on a really, really sort of not just grand scale, but you could say on a total scale, harvesting your data. So what's happening is that every input you make, every Google search you do, every time you use any kind of tool these platforms are providing, every Facebook photo you tag, every search you do, whatever it is, you are training and you are sort of bringing into being a now still kind of dumb artificial intelligence that is good at doing very specific tasks. Facebook's so-called deep face software is better at recognizing faces than any human in the history of humanity has ever been, simply because of the fact that it has in a very short time seen about 3 billion more faces than any human could ever see in their lifetime. So now we're still sort of at the stage of the intelligence of a rat that is very good at doing something specific. The changing of the infrastructure also works in another way. You might have heard of this project. It's called Aquila. It's under development and has recently also been, I think, put on hold because one of Elon Musk's rockets crashed into one of these drones because they were using the same airfield and destroyed it. This is a Facebook project based on the idea to provide wireless internet access to developing countries where there is no wire infrastructure. Which, of course, sounds like a super nice idea. We know what mobile telephony has brought to Africa in terms of progress. And I'm sure that internet access will bring the same sort of boost to the economic system and the political system. What struck me is the imagery being used on the lower right side. So what does that remind you of? It really reminds me of this kind of imagery. So this is really what's happening. By providing access to, say, a billion more people, Facebook is doing something very cheap in the way that, in compared to what they're getting back by expanding their user base by, say, a billion people. The same way they are now trying to get access to China, where they still effectively have no footing, and they do so by providing surveillance software to the Chinese government. I'm going to show you a little video by the Facebook artificial intelligence research to sort of skip from the infrastructural to the more metaphysical aspect of what they're talking about. I hope the sound works.
Our goal is to build intelligent machines to help people in their daily lives. What makes us intelligent is our ability to learn. And this is what we're trying to reproduce in machines. And to some extent, we get inspiration from biology. What we can do with current technology is build networks of simulated neurons on the order of magnitude of the brain of a mouse, let's say. So the way we train our machine, we show a bunch of images of, say, breeds of dogs, and for each image, we tell it what it is.
We want the machine to be able to learn to perform the tasks. The more we show them examples, the better they get.
And what's very interesting is that after a while, it can do this with a new dog it's never seen before. It's able to exhibit superhuman performance on a particular task. So how can we help people's life with this?
Friends 937, newsfeed. Lindsay Russell updated her cover photo yesterday at 10:29 p.m. This image may contain outdoor, cloud, foliage, planet, tree. This image may contain 6 people, child, close-up, mug, one or more people, jewelry, smiling, 19 likes, 3 comments liked.
Now I can see the picture in my head, like, yeah, you shouldn't have been that close up. Like, now I can say it.
I love it, you have no idea. This is amazing.
That whole saying of pictures being worth 1,000 words, I think it's true, but unless you have somebody to describe it to you, even having like 3 words just helps flesh out all the details that I can't see.
I feel like I can fit in, that there's more I can do.
I can just call my mom like, yay, I seen your picture, and she'll be like, what? She was like, how you see it? Because my phone read it to me. It's new. And I'm going to mess with my mother head so much.
In the future, we'll be able to give a complete description of the image.
The two people happy? Are they sad? Are they holding hands with one another? It's this kind of comment that a human would make.
We have systems in the lab that are able to do this, and they will be deployed over the next few years. Artificial intelligence systems are going to be an extension of our brains, the same way cars are an extension of our legs. They're not going to replace us. They're going to amplify everything we do, augmenting your memory, giving you instant knowledge. And they're going to allow us to concentrate on doing things that are properly human.
What first really struck me when watching this video was the really biblical language, or the symbolism.
Fusion TV.
Oh, sorry. Also playing. That literally this was about making the blind see, you know? Second of all, of course, it's quite telling that it's only women in this video that are subject to being blind and having to be made able to see. Third of all, what really struck me was that Jan LeCun, who's the head of artificial intelligence and one of the sort of really global leaders in research in artificial intelligence, really sounds like a computer voice when he starts talking. In the beginning of the video, you think it's a voice assistant that's reading to you. And third of all, that the way that they sell it, in the end, when we have all these metaphors about literally talking about the same thing that McLuhan talked about, that they are extensions, that artificial intelligence will be an extension and will not replace us. I wonder if they really think that, or if that is sort of a propaganda move to divert us from much more pressing questions about not what artificial intelligence is being able to do, because if you think what this sort of really clunky piece of software is able to do now, namely read in a very bad voice to you what's in the picture, if you think that a couple of years ahead towards better software and towards something like neural implants, it will actually be possible to make the blind see and to create this image on the neurocortex. That's a reality you will all witness in your lifetime, probably still within your young lifetime. But the pressing question, of course, is who owns this infrastructure? Who owns this software? Who has the power over which images to create, which images to make you see? So there's a huge potential for political and social and metaphysical manipulation in this. And then, of course, the second question is who profits? Who makes the money from it? And what do we get back? So this is, I think, the big problem that we are facing right now, that we slowly sort of become aware that the internet is not for free and has never been, that Facebook and all these other platforms provide a very valuable and time-consuming and funny service to us, but in the end, we end up providing much more for Facebook than it provides for us. You could say that the transparency that we always demand from technology is something that has completely inverted. So it's us being transparent, not the technology, and I'm not looking into the computer, it's looking into me. But to come back to Jan LeCun, whose name sounds an awful lot like Jacques Lacan, this is what I also found kind of funny, that the sort of most advanced AI research is based on a paradigm called optimal brain damage. I stumbled upon this when I was studying computer science in the early 2000s. This is a paper from, I think, the late 1990s. And the idea is that you have a neural network and that brains or neural networks are usually tend to redundancies. So to teach them to do something specific quite well, what you do is you basically mutilate it, you chop off connections. So this is why we're at the place in the time where we are right now, where artificial intelligence, the deep in deep learning or deep anything or deep shit, has nothing to do with an actual sort of profundity or depth. But just it's just its vector, so it goes into the depth, it goes down. It's a vertical way of learning, whereas what they are starting to work on now is to build up horizontal connections between those different vectors. And once we have entered this way of relational artificial intelligence, it will become more general. This is just because Jacques Lacan and the mirror stage. And now I would like to switch topics and talk about a different aspect of infrastructure before I come to an end. This guy you probably all know, who's inspecting an Iranian nuclear facility that was attacked by the most sophisticated cyber attack recorded in history. That was a couple of years ago, I think discovered in 2011, but it has been at work for an unknown amount of time before. It was a computer worm called Stuxnet. Some of you might have heard of it. It was a highly, highly sophisticated cyber weapon that was addressing one tiny little valve in this nuclear facility that would sort of slightly put out of sync a centrifuge and effectively shut it down without letting the people there actually know that something was being sabotaged. This was, as came out, there's a fantastic documentary about it called Zero Days. You can find streams on the internet. This only came out because it sort of leaked on the internet and started doing damage elsewhere. But what came out was that this was something being done on a very large scale with the support of governments and fundings in the billions. And this is something that I think, or I'm sure that we're not addressing in the right way yet, because as you know, there are Geneva conventions for A, B, and C, atomic, biological, and chemical weapons, but we haven't reached the D yet, the digital. So there is no international convention for digital warfare. However, there is digital war, and it's going on right as we speak. Digital warfare has shifted from these sort of highly sophisticated attacks that are still, of course, going on and are going to become much more sophisticated to something that happened late last year in a forum where a user called Anna Senpai posted the source code to a botnet that everyone could download and start using, that was able to hijack machines, computers, but most of all IoT, Internet of Things devices. That means thermostats, webcams, stuff like this, and use it in so-called denial of service attacks against infrastructures. This is nothing new. This is basically how cyber attacks always work. It's flood something that you want to shut down with traffic until it breaks down. But with the advent of the Internet of Things, what happened is that suddenly the amount of accessible devices for software like this shot through the roof. So what the Mirai software could do was basically, and did, knock the entire country of Liberia off the internet, shut down Twitter and Amazon for a day, close down the heating system in Finland, stuff like this. So we have shifted from highly complex, sophisticated, government-run digital warfare to something where you can basically turn an army of toasters into something that will kill the entire internet in the Netherlands. To give you just a brief insight, there are funny websites where you can track. So basically, it's quite certain that at least, I would say, one third of the computers and smartphones in this room are right now engaged in an act of warfare or sabotage. This is live, so you can see different names of different botnets and countries, and you can see how it's recording what's going on. These are attacking websites, electrical grids, you name it. I'm gonna let it run in the background and we can look back in a few minutes. There's another website by IBM which can look what Mirai is doing at the moment. It used to be live, so it looked a little bit like bombs were being dropped, and much nicer. To show you how insecure all these systems are also is, it took me about 2 minutes this morning to Google websites where you can access unsecured webcams. This is a research project called Insecam, so they try to establish that there is nothing illegal being done, but you can browse it by even different manufacturers of webcams and see how vulnerable they are. So given how much time it took me to find this, imagine how much information you can find by 15 minutes on the dark net. Okay, to come to an end, I just very briefly want to talk about yet another new infrastructure or approach to infrastructure that is being made that is based on the blockchain, something that I think maybe Dan will talk a little bit more about this afternoon, and entities like Ethereum that, is Ethereum, do you know what Ethereum is? You know what Bitcoin is, right? So Bitcoin is a cryptocurrency that is based on unique transactions, and it carries behind it this so-called blockchain. It's like a rat's tail, and every interaction that is has ever been made with this entity is recorded on the blockchain. The idea that Ethereum had, it was founded by a Ukrainian, I think, teenager called Vitalik Buterin a couple of years ago, was that you could apply this model to any kind of authentication process. You could use it for voting, to authenticate any kind of contract, and to create smart contracts and smart societies, and always sort of cut out the middleman. It's an incredibly libertarian idea, which sort of goes so far to the left spectrum that it sort of circles back to the right spectrum. There's a very interesting book by David Columbia about Bitcoin as right-wing politics. It's a good read. So Ethereum is something that has the idea that you don't need a government, you can sort of figure it out yourself, you don't need a bank, you can figure it out yourself. And this was soon thereafter turned into this very menacing looking logo for a company called DAO, which means Decentralized Autonomous Organization, which had the idea to even broaden the scope of what blockchain and Ethereum could do. As you can see, maybe these trigrams that circle around the Ethereum logo seem familiar to you. You can find them in the South Korean flag. There's the so-called bagua, the oldest pieces of Chinese writing from the I Ching. And legend has it that the Chinese writing system was based on them, which of course is not true. But this is sort of at the center of Chinese philosophy also. They come to us also in the very early days of the idea of computability when Gottfried Wilhelm Leibniz learns about them in a letter from a Jesuit missionary from China who says, well, you see these trigrams, they have a very close resemblance to the binary numbers that you have just invented and that every computing technology is based on. This is the letter that he got, and the correspondence between the zeros and ones. And the other way that the DAO is encountering us, except for the distributed autonomous organization and as feedback mechanisms in cybernetics, is an NSA ubiquitous surveillance program called TAO, Tailored Access Operations. Thank you very much.
Also stand, or do you feel like sitting down?
I'm fine standing.
Great. So I would like to give you the opportunity to ask questions, anything you'd like to ask Paul. Yeah, I see many questions already.
Hi, thank you for the talk. I was wondering, when it comes to the simulation of the visual as this extension that Facebook is trying to produce. Something that also strikes me is that they're completely ignoring, like it's only about the visual hegemony, so they completely ignore the other senses, like yeah, of course sound, because it is about speech as well, but like smell, for instance, or touch, or any of the other senses. How do you feel about that? Or what it,
It's a really good question. I mean, first of all, the reason why machine intelligence is interested in pictures is not because of any kind of what they show or what they mean to us, but just because they're highly interesting and necessarily complex pieces of data. So, of course, they don't see anything in those pictures. The way that they're being used then, of course, is in this purely visual way, because technology thus far has only given us visual access to this. We haven't yet reached the stage where it's become completely immersive, although I think once we've entered the stage where we can actually fuse technology with the cognitive, with the nervous system and the brain, then we will be perfectly able also to create smell and sound and any kind of hallucination or perception. Does that answer your question?
Not really, right? Yeah, in a way. I'm also thinking, and I don't know, there's no solution, or it's not linear in that sense, but I could think of a communication through smell or something, or like anything else that could go beyond like this form of technology, since it's that much simple. But I don't know, it's an open question. I think I appreciate your answer.
Well, I think in general that we haven't figured out how thinking works yet, and we haven't really figured out how many different forms of communication work. I mean, now we're in the early stages of research into plant communication or animal communication. So I'm sure we're gonna see quite a few things in the next decades in terms of different ways of communicating. And then, of course, unfortunately, different ways of exploiting that.
There was another question right there.
Do you have any idea, because now you explained us a lot about what is happening, but do you have any idea how to maybe go against it? Or maybe,
Sure, I mean, I don't think going against it is necessarily the right way. I'm an advocate for critical participation. So I think, because it's, you know, people say, well, you're not, nobody forces you to use Facebook or Google or anything, but the reality is that there is absolutely no outside. There is no opting out. You're in if you're trying to be out, and if you're in, you're in anyway. So what you can do and what we can all do in our respective fields and theory and practice is to engage with what is going on and to shift something that has entered our minds a long time ago in the form of institutional critique to something we could call infrastructural critique, to actually go into politics, to change the way that that legal frameworks are being made or not yet being made. And then, of course, it's also the way you use technology and what technology you use. And by using a Mac, you automatically subscribe to certain boundaries and you give away a certain amount of data. And you agree to the fact that you can only encrypt your data to a certain degree. And Mac or Apple can encrypt it for you, but also against you, if you will. So there are ways of opening up technology, of using open source software like Linux, of using other kinds of smartphones, of using Tor and email encryption. The technology to go against it or to sort of critically engage with it is there, just people have to use it.
Thank you.
Some more questions over there.
There, in the second room. Hey, thanks for your talk. At one point you said the transparency we use to demand of technology has completely inverted. It is looking at us. We are transparent to it now. Can you elaborate on this point a bit? Because I thought it was quite...
Well, I think the biggest problem is what we call the cloud, you know, because what happened in the recent years is that cables are slowly disappearing, that our devices become thinner and thinner and more ephemeral, and sort of sooner or later we're just going to have sort of a piece of glass or nothing at all in our hand. So this is one trick that is being played, and it's not even sort of to make the rabbit disappear in the hat. It's kind of really getting rid of the hat entirely, you know? So, but what's happening is this is not actually getting thinner or smaller or anyway, it's just being put elsewhere. And it's not being put somewhere like into the cloud and it magically disappears and it's all around us. But the cloud is the exact opposite. It's a smoke bomb. It's a smoke screen that effectively obscures a massive campaign of data centralization. So this is one thing that's going wrong, that all your data is that's not stored on a local hard drive that you put on Dropbox or anywhere else is, it's not flying around. It's literally somewhere being stored in massive computing data centers that also have a huge climatic effect, for example. So you can look that up. I don't remember what the website is called, but you can look up the carbon footprint of every Google search that you do, for example. And while the technology is sort of, in this process, technology really effectively becomes a total black box. You know, you can't even open your computer anymore. You can't repair it anymore. There's a huge fight going on about the right to repair. So, you know, if say you're a skilled person and your Apple breaks down and you want to open up your MacBook, and they make it increasingly difficult, but also on a legal level, you will sort of become a criminal if you fix your own computer or the smart system in your car, you know? So this is something that's going on that I think we should watch in a very critical way. And the other way, of course, is that this is the way that transparency has been taken from us, in the way that we don't know what is being done with our data. We don't know what is being done with our hardware. On the other hand, we have been, or the platforms increasingly are being designed in a way that train us to provide a certain kind of data to them. And that means making us transparent to it. A couple of years ago, when big data sort of suddenly became a phenomenon, it was like striking oil before inventing the car, you know? So nobody knew what to do with all the data. And then two things happened. They started working on ways of trying to make sense of all this raw material. And the second one was trying to build ways to guarantee that the data that was being produced was already in some kind of form interesting for big data algorithms. This is why Facebook keeps changing their interface and keeps giving you more options or different options on how to fine-tune that, because we're doing the work for them already by saying, not only I like it, but I like it, I love it, wow, sad face, whatever, you know? This is unpaid labor. And while we are unable to look inside the computer and into what Facebook does or what the hardware actually does, those platforms become increasingly good at looking inside us because we let them.
And how do you think this this really biblical language is related to this transparency then?
I mean, all in all, this is kind of a biblical process. Also, if you look at I left that out for time reasons, but if you look at the idea of behind Ethereum and the DAO to create something like this algorithmic agency where you don't need the human hand anymore, you bring back into being something that Marx called sort of the natural laws of capitalism, that it is a natural law, you know, or Adam Smith called the invisible hand, or if you trace it further back, it's just, you know, the hand of God.
Yeah. Thanks.
One other question right next.
I was wondering, since we are feeding the AI with our data, don't we have a responsibility to open up all our photos and put them online to show the AI alternate way of seeing, for example? So I was wondering, is hiding the best way to deal with this?
No, also there is no hiding, absolutely.
Yeah,
not.
Because you said it on the question before.
Yeah.
What's the, you know, how to?
Well, the problem is that, of course, and this could be funny to discuss with Dan Keller this afternoon when he speaks about Rocco's Basilisk in terms of what do we do now for the future AI. The problem with access or with providing information or providing food for this being is that we sort of, all we do is sort of shovel the stuff in there, you know? And then there are big corporations and governments who actually cook the meal and feed it to the babies. So it's very difficult to say if a certain kind of input that we produce, if we say we change our image strategies to show the AI or this growing being what to learn, is actually something that helps, as long as we don't actually take influence in the platforms and the infrastructure themselves. It doesn't really matter, because all we produce is Soylent Green, if you will, you know?
Yeah, so maybe we should test the AI and really ask for openness about how it works. And
absolutely.
Yeah.
I mean, there are initiatives to open this. Elon Musk, who's definitely probably not the nice guy he looks like he is, but he has started something called OpenAI, and there are lots of different partnerships on opening up research there. Problem being that, of course, the people with the most money and the most power have the most influence. But I highly encourage you in any way to engage with these processes and to talk to people in research, to use this stuff in the way you produce art, because yeah, it's still better than doing nothing.
Paul, I also have a question. Namely, you said that this IE-driven future mainly, or these technology companies mainly want our data, and this is their main objective. Now, looking at what happened in during Brexit and during the presidential election, there seems to be kind of like an old regime of monitoring information that has no longer kind of like a realistic grip what is happening in terms of polling. And we have seen that that many people who get their information from online platforms actually interact in kind of like new ways with each other. And I was just wondering, kind of like that gap between non-interference, that these technology companies just want data, and kind of like say that they have no political interest whatsoever, they just want the data, like how that can kind of like still have very distinct political effects and what these effects are. And I was wondering kind of like if you could elaborate a little bit about this dynamic.
I made the wrong impression. There is no such thing as raw data. It always comes with an historical and political and social context, and everyone who's working with data on this larger scale has some kind of agenda. So there is no such way of no such thing as non-deterministic communication on the internet. What struck me really hard recently was one moment when, because everyone keeps talking about how Donald Trump talks like a complete imbecile, you know, that it's not even language anymore that he uses. But it struck me that maybe that's intended. Maybe that's not because it's crazy, but maybe it's because there is a software that's generating language for him from sort of, you know, taken from, you know, what Cambridge Analytica does, for example, and that's directed not at the people listening to it, but already back into the filters of the platforms that will then generate the language again. Mm-hmm. So there is a very interesting, hypothetical process, of course, going on, where these infrastructures and platforms have taken on a certain amount of autonomy and have a certain kind of their own political agenda. It stands to argue if they understand what politics is, you know? But it's conceivable that there is something going on that has nothing to do with us anymore at all.
Is there any way we can hold them accountable for the way they provide information to us, or if that can be addressed or brought to the open, or?
And that's a huge question that we're already facing, and that's gonna be, I talked briefly about digital rights, which is something that right now is about in this, on the level of maritime law in the 18th century. So you have de facto monopolies like the East India Company used to have. And nobody really knows what's going on because it's far away somewhere on the internet, you know? Mm-hmm. In terms of accountability, I mean, there's been a lot of discussion about, you know, how Facebook can be held accountable for providing fake news and how they should actually guarantee that this is not happening, which they're trying to do, I think. The question, however, is a more far-reaching one, and it's the question whether we can hold algorithms or software accountable for anything, which then leads to a much more far-reaching question, is whether we assign agency and with that intelligence to these kinds of beings, and then are able to hold them accountable for that. It's not only about election or manipulation or stuff like this, but it's also if you have a car crash in a Tesla and you had autopilot on, is it your fault or is it Tesla's fault? Is it the car's fault or is it the company's fault? To come back to the title of my lecture, we're in deep shit.
Yeah, right. So I think we have time for one more question, if there is one more less pressing question, and otherwise we will go to the break. No, it doesn't appear to be like that. So we will reconvene here at 12 o'clock. There's a short break, and then the conference will continue.
Thank you.